Hello all, I am Prithvi and I will be explaining the isotropic and kinematic hardening models in this video. This is a continuation of my previous video here, so if you haven't seen this, I would recommend watching that video before you proceed here. The link is provided in the description. The isotropic and kinematic hardening are the most basic models in plasticity. Of course, there are other models which will not be discussed here. Let me explain both of these with a simple uniaxial loading case as shown here. Assume that we have loaded the sample till yield point and the corresponding stress strain curve is also shown. Point A corresponds to our initial yield point and let's take that as 800 MPa and let the compressive yield be minus 800 MPa. Let me emphasize a point here. The yield strength is not constant and it varies with the load history. On to the right, we have the von Mises yield surface corresponding to the loading state. Also take a note of this point. If you are in the elastic regime, you'll be inside the yield surface. If you are in the elastoplastic regime, you'll be on the yield surface, but you can never go beyond it. As you go along OA in the stress strain curve, you'll be going along O'A' in the yield surface plot. And at point A, you'll be on the yield surface represented by A'. Let's further load the specimen to B and let's see how the yield surface evolves under isotropic hardening. Isotropic hardening is characterized by uniform yield surface expansion. At point B, the yield surface will look like this. Uniform yield expansion results in the symmetry of tension and compression behavior. You can see that both the tensile yield strength B' and compressive yield strength C' have the same magnitude. Another point to note is, as you go from A to B, the yield surface expands simultaneously along with it. Here I have just shown them at the initial and final points. Let's see what happens as we unload from point B. With respect to yield surface plot, we are on B'. Upon unloading, we go inside the yield surface, so we are in the elastic regime until we hit C' on the other side of the surface. At C' again, it starts to plasticize in compression. As we load further in compression to D, we have the new yield surface as shown. All these explanations go into mathematical description of the yield surface evolution, which takes the form f of sigma equal to k, which is a function of plastic strain. For each of the surfaces, we'll have values like k1, k2 and k3. Now, let's see how the yield surface evolves in kinematic hardening. We will start from the same point shown here. Let's load it to B. Unlike the previous one, the kinematic hardening is characterized by a shift in the yield surface. The center of the ellipse shifts by alpha, here it will be 200, and alpha is known as the back stress. The new yield surface will look like this. As we gain some strength in tension, we lose some strength in compression. This asymmetry in tension and compression behavior is called as the Bauschinger's effect. Now, as we unload from B', we hit the yield surface at C' and it starts plasticizing earlier in compression as compared to isotropic hardening. And as we load again to D, the surface shifts accordingly. Let me explain two other points using the stress strain curve. Let's load it further from D. As we load, we would yield at E, and as we load further, it will join A and we obtain a closed loop. This range is constant and equals twice the initial yield, which is 1600 here. This is due to the fact that the size and shape of the yield surface is constant. Let's see what happens if we load it to a very high strain and then unload it. Let's load our specimen from O to A to B until F. Let's unload till G and further load till it hits C again. Observe that at very high strain, the reverse yielding occurs in the tension region itself, which is an interesting observation. The form of the equation here is f of sigma minus alpha equal to k. Now, let's look at the applicability of these models, but do take this with a grain of salt. First, if you try to model only monotonic response as like this, you may use either isotropic or kinematic hardening, it shouldn't matter. If you try to model cyclic deformation for one cycle where we have tension compression symmetry, we need to use isotropic hardening. If you model cyclic deformation for one cycle with Bauschinger's effect, you may use kinematic hardening. If you try to model a more complicated cyclic deformation for multiple cycles as shown here, I don't think both isotropic and kinematic hardening will work. So till 10 to 20 cycles, we may use advanced models like crystal plasticity. But if you want to accurately capture the cyclic deformation, say for 10,000 cycles, to the best of my knowledge, there is no plasticity model available yet. And that's the reason why plasticity is still an active field of research. Thank you very much for your attention.